Members, we now resume. Next, Mr. Phun Siew Peng. Thank you. Even the experts could not say when the pandemic might be over, so this might be a long battle. The government's second round of measures under the Anti-epidemic Fund, the focus is to retain and create jobs. More than $80 billion would be spent by the government to pay for employees' wages. A number of members are concerned whether there would be loopholes, which would mean that the money is not targeted by the employees. I think the government and the society as a whole should wake up to the crisis. In the UK, the government is paying 80% of the wages to employees. Even in Macau, there is a cash payout scheme. So the government should come up with new measures as soon as possible. The economic fluctuations might very well continue into the future. So the SAR government should learn their lesson and come up with a new social security system. This includes an unemployment assistance proposed by many labor unions, or even an unemployment loan. Many workers are in deep plight and they have to rely on their credit cards for their daily spendings. In other words, if the government can create a loan fund to support these people, the government would not have to shoulder heavy commitments. Otherwise, when we see economic fluctuations again, the grassroots workers would be the ones affected the most.
I have a few questions. I would like to see if they could be answered. So this time, all walks of life have been affected. I'm not sure whether you can cover all the industries and try to assist all those who have been affected. Yesterday, I received a letter from the tourism industry. Well, originally, some of them were very happy, thinking that they would get $5,000 for each registered tour guides. But then now you need to submit proof that they have worked consecutively for 60 days. Basically, last year, many tour guides did not meet this criteria. With this threshold, it means that some tour guides may only have worked 59 days and not meet the 60-day criteria, and they would not be able to receive the $5,000 subsidy. It's very difficult for them to comply with this criteria. So could you consider helping these affected tour guides to also receive a subsidy during these difficult times? D2 mentioned job creation on about 30,000 jobs, which means about 6 billion. And then, so you're talking about 200 students, and then for arts sector, talking about 550 jobs, and then for those who are cleaning government buildings and schools, about 3,300 jobs. You hope to create about 3,000 temporary jobs. So when will you be able to to open up these job opportunities? Oh, Mr. Poon, there is no time to address these questions. Perhaps you can first address the question on tour guides. Mr. Yao, please. The tourism industry has been heavily hit by the epidemic. So they would receive a $500 extra subsidy. As the paper said, these would be mainly from the tourism industry. As you know, many of them are temporary workers. So when we considered this with the industry, we thought that will be more relaxed. As long as you have worked 60 days out of the 365 days last year, and then you could prove that you have been working for 60 days, or you have been leading tours for 20 days per month, then you would be able to receive the subsidy. We understand that the situation was quite tough at the end of last year. We will consider whether we would relax the restrictions. Next, Mr. Xiu Kafai. Thank you. Well, this is the Anti-epidemic Fund 2.0, and actually many friends from the different industries are grateful, especially it can really help some of the workers last through this difficult period. You're talking about $18,000 limit per employee for the enterprises, and that means that they'll be have a $9,000 subsidy, and then you're also increasing the cash flow from $2 million to $4 million for the businesses. And so many businesses are very grateful, and they feel that there is hope. However, we can always do better, and there's always room for improvement, especially during this difficult period. I've been sitting here for the entire 2 hours, and I see many legislators have been using their time to criticize the government in what industry the government is not assisting. I've always said that people don't understand, no matter how you want to be helpful, some people will not be satisfied. Many people do not understand. I think the $9,000 subsidy for 6 months is quite a good measure. But no one has told us or explained to us how the employer would use this $9,000 funding. I don't quite understand. I think you need to explain it. In the last round, well, you explained to me how you're going to use the funding, and then I will be able to explain it to the industry. You first need to make me understand so I can help you explain to the industry. Well, yesterday, Mr. Yu Xiong called me 10 in the evening and asked me about and talked to me about this. I asked him why he understood this. He told me that he already asked the Secretary of Labor. But then today, you need to try to make us understand your policy. You first need to make us understand so that we'll be able to ask questions that pertain to the policy. We still don't understand, like up till now, I still don't understand how you're going to apply for this $9,000. You just tell us that, oh, you're going to help the employers to retain employees for 3 months. From January till March, many employees had to take no pay leave, or some of them could only work for half the week and they only get paid half the salary. There are many such examples. So this $80 billion funding is crucial in this round of anti-epidemic fund. Can you try to explain to us? This is the most crucial part. Members have asked questions, but then we never have enough time to hear a detailed explanation. Well, I'm sure you know some people are not covered in the AEF. There are many self-employed people in the beauty parlor sectors. They are not unemployed. However, their income has decreased by 70%. How can you provide subsidies to help them go through this period? You have to give us examples and tell us that even if you don't apply for a certain fund, you'll be able to apply for another elderly fund. Give us examples. Help us understand. I still don't quite understand how you're going to pay out these $9,000. Well, I don't think you need to address my question because I'm going to be here all day long. I just want to hear an explanation on how we could apply for the fund. All right, next, Ms. Chen Hoyan. Thank you. In the first round of anti-epidemic fund, many industries were not covered, and now the government has rolled out the anti-epidemic fund 2.0, and I support in principle this fund, and I hope that many people could be subsidized. However, you're still leaving some industries out or some people out. You have included many industries in the first and second round of AEF. However, this is not enough. I'm talking about the basic grassroots. In the past few months, Hong Kong has not only been affected by the pandemic. Starting from June last year, because of a social movement, many industries and businesses have already suffered. You wonder why some businesses cannot survive in just 1 or 2 months. It is because they have already been heavily hit by all the social movement since last June. And many employees need to take no pay leave or only get paid half their salary. You're leaving out industries such as laundry services or hair salons and even self-employed people like magicians, etc. Even if you're rolling out the AEF 3.0, I'm sure you're still going to leave people out. Why do you insist that the CSSA will be able to help these people? Many people do not want to apply for the CSSA. They are just hit by this difficult period for a few months. I understand that you want to take measures expeditiously. But I don't understand why you can't change the name of the funding. Will you call it anti-epidemic fund or a special scheme of assistance? You can name it whatever you want. However, I think you should try to change the name so that everybody could also be included. Well, look at yourselves. How many of you are over the age of 65? People who have reached 65 are still capable to work, yet they do not need to pay MPF. Why do you not help this group of people as well? You don't understand because you are not affected by it. There are still many who are working. and they are not being assisted during this round of funding. How can you help them? Mr. Law, this is actually a scheme of assistance to the unemployed. Of course, we can try to do a bit more PR and then help people understand what this scheme is. Well, you can actually go apply for the elderly subsidy, and I hope to take this opportunity to try to stop negative stereotyping. We have the responsibility to help those who are not able to sustain themselves, and we hope that these schemes could help the underprivileged. For those who are unemployed, we do have a scheme that the employer can receive a $5,000 for 6 months for hiring people over the age of 65, and so they would have an extra subsidy for 6 months. But for those who are receiving a lower income, then they can go through two other schemes. One is the elderly subsidy. OSLA. So they can get $3,580 if they're over the age of 70. If their income is lower than $10,100, then they can also receive WFA. Thank you. Next, Mr. Charles Mock. Well, you said you're trying to retain jobs in the second round of AEF. I understand that you can't provide 100% assistance to everyone, but then there are many self-employed people who are not benefiting from this funding. Those who do not contribute to MPF when they're over the age of 65, and they are not included as well. So even if you can receive the $9,000 subsidy, it's still too little, and the money will go directly into the pocket of the employer.
And for some enterprises, the subsidy is not much needed, because for major corporations, the subsidies would only increase their profit. But you refuse to pay the employees directly for the sake of convenience. For the IT sector, especially for startups and SMEs, cash flow is now the biggest challenge. You cannot ignore them, or else all the funds and efforts you have invested down the years would go down the drains. But still, the government is only focusing on their own convenience. For the six-month rental waiver for Cyberport and the Science Park, it was a good move, but the employers did not follow suit. They were asking for a subsidy to operating expenses, but it has not materialized. So such injustice was created by the government itself. In terms of support to our startups, our sector is not enjoying enough support. You said you would support esports, but now their work has completely stopped. They have no revenue at all and no rental subsidy. And in terms of STEM, everything has stopped as well. There is no subsidy for rents or operating expenses for mahjong, parlors, and well, they are getting $100,000. So are you supporting gambling? So does it mean that the IT sector is less important than the gambling industry? You have a 5G application scheme, law tech fund, etc. But these are indirect support. They would have to compete with other companies, and some companies would enjoy business, others don't. What is needed now is a universal rental subsidy to all companies. According to a media report, the catering industry is getting $13 billion, transport industry $8 billion, construction industry $3.4 billion, financial services $170 million. for the INT sector, only indirect measures are being offered. The Secretary told us that they have been trying to do more, and I'm thankful for that, but the truth is it's not enough. That might not be the fault of the Bureau. The mentality of the entire government is administrative convenience. It is not hard to pinpoint STEM or INT companies, but why aren't you providing rental subsidy for them? If they close down, all your efforts down the years would go down the drains. Even if you offer a $9,000 grants, that would not be enough to save them. I would invite Mr. Nicholas Yang to talk about the INT sector. While this is not the fault of the INT Bureau, it's about the entire government. We are offering different amounts of subsidy, and some for certain sectors, we don't offer any sectors. Premises that would benefit are the ones who are asked to close under the laws. In other words, premises subject to restrictions. That is why we are providing some kind of relief or subsidy for these businesses. What about the retail sector? Retail premises asked to close. The e-sport companies, in a way, they could not operate. They could be prosecuted. We have an employment subsidy scheme and other schemes. Why can't you offer $100,000 across the board to all SMEs? Mr. Mok, please wait for the second round. Your time is up. Next, Mr. Vincent Chang. For AEF 2.0, we believe the focus is to support enterprises so they can stay afloat. And this is something we acknowledge. But at the same time, we are concerned about the unemployed. This morning, a number of members talked about a fund to support the unemployed. This is something the DAB has proposed. We should offer $6,000 for 3 months as a short-term support measure. I hope the Secretary would acknowledge that and follow up. And you are talking about a number of pillars to support the unemployed. For example, the love caring scheme or the love upgrading scheme. Recently, the DAB has been offering a caring fund. We have been giving out a few thousand dollars to people. Some of them are unemployed. And we asked them to join the love upgrading scheme, but many of them never heard of the scheme, so more promotion is needed. I called some welfare organizations recently. Most of the facilities are not open, and no courses would be offered until May at the earliest. So a lot of organizations are waiting, even for online courses. They would involve different modes of instruction. No one can enjoy the full $5,800 subsidy. To enjoy a full subsidy, they would have to attend a full day job from 9 to 5, as well as complete the night courses before they can enjoy the full entitlement. And the daily level is $153.8, and this is not enough to cover their meals and transportation. For the love upgrading scheme, people would have to wait 3 months before they can enjoy or receive a payout, which is way too late. For the scheme, would you consider dispersing the money first, and can you come up with more courses? At earlier Finance Committee special meetings, we addressed this question. in face of the pandemic, some of our courses encountered difficulties, and we would speed up the resumption of online courses based on the epidemic. As for the daily sum you mentioned, it was unadjusted. It was the sum before we adjusted the $4,000 cap. When the cap is increased to $5,800, the daily subsidy would increase. We would work hard on promotions. Like we said last August, we have been trying to promote this scheme to more people. But if we offer an allowance before courses are attended, that would be against the whole idea of the scheme. I understand that the daily average of $153,800 is based on the $4,000 cap. But even if when after you raise the ceiling, the daily rate would not increase by much more. I think the disbursement comes way too late. I confirmed yesterday that no one from the organizations would be eligible. No one could take the courses. Even if you would not reimburse the money upfront, can you offer an extra, say, $3,000? You are asking people to work from 9 to 9 in order to get the $5,800. This is unreasonable. Can you refine the scheme? The comments are noted. Mr. Tony Chair, thank you. On the 21st of February, the Finance Committee approved the $30 billion anti-epidemic fund. The COVID-19 pandemic worsened. Basically, the entire world has been affected, and many sectors in Hong Kong are being affected. The majority have been hit, and some of them came to a standstill. So for the AEF 2.0, even though it involves $137.5 billion, which is substantial, I believe that this would help. Of course, different members would have different views, and there are inadequacies, and this is something I acknowledge. I agree with the Chief Secretary that the key is to get the help out as soon as possible, because some people are in deep plight. We should support people who need help, and that is why we should support the funding. Very often, speed is very important, and we should be more lenient rather than too strict. I believe different departments are working out the details. And in terms of securing employment, I think this involves the most funds. In terms of my sector, you talked about retaining jobs, but nonetheless, 6 months is not a short time. You should offer some flexibility. There would be wastage nonetheless. The government would hire during this time. even your measure last December would create jobs, and this involves professionals, and a lot of them would like to join the government. So if they are able to prove that they are switching jobs, would they be made eligible? For professionals, very often certain construction sites would sign contracts with professionals. The Finance Committee often took a very long time in approving projects, so there have been a lot of delays, while some projects have stalled due to the pandemic. So professionals would no longer be engaged at the end of projects. So can you be more lenient in this regard? And in terms of job and advancement, after the pandemic, how, when the economy is restarted, how can we add value to the sectors or employees? Again, the government should be more lenient. If you can come up with new measures to create value for us, is this something you would consider? Thank you. Chief Secretary, I would focus on the third question first. Mr. Chair was very correct. We are trying to create opportunities out of a crisis. We are preparing for a rejuvenation of the economy. We want to add value for employees, whether for engineers, architects, they can adopt modern construction methods, and this is part of our thinking.
Mr. Chiu Ka-jun, thank you, Chairman. DCS and Secretary have mentioned CSSA for like 5 or 6 times in the entire morning. I'm not sure whether Mr. Lo Chi Kwong thinks that CSSA will be sufficient for survival. You do not provide enough money for rent or for a basic survival. You have already cut down the subsidy by 10% and 20% for 3-person families and 4-person families respectively. And you have also cut down the special subsidy for moving homes and so forth. I have mentioned it many times before. Even in January of 2019, when a motion was moved to improve the financial assistance subsidy, I still think there is a huge question mark and perhaps a large exclamation mark because many concerns have not been addressed. Yesterday, a report was published by the HKCSS that an unemployment scheme should be rolled out and also to try to relax the criteria. I'm not sure whether Mr. Law has noted this report. We should not only look at the asset restriction. You should also help able-bodied persons to try to lower the bar. For example, for the WFA, then it should be 257,000 per person, and for a four-person family, it should be 25,700 or about 50,000. Would the administration consider trying to put CSSA and WFA on par and to address the concern of the HKCSS? Would Dr. Law like to take this question? Thank you, Chairman. Well, under the CSSA, a four-person family will get around $16,000 per month, but some of them may get a bit more, some a bit less, depending on their situation. There's a paper that is in line to seek approval from the Finance Committee to make improvements, and that includes a drastic change in the measure to try to provide more support to the needy. I have noted the analysis given by the HKCSS yesterday. In consideration of the unemployment scheme this time, we looked into the current system, including looking into the old age allowance, and we also looked into the working family assistance situation to try to find a balance out of all these different subsidies. We think that we have reached quite a good balance this time. And Mr. Xu, many members have suggested you try to cover all industries because they think that you have left certain people up, and I would like to speak up for those homeless people. The ESS is taken reference from the schemes in overseas countries. Would you also consider learning from the UK experience and to provide assistance to the homeless, such as providing accommodations for homeless people? We are also able to provide assistance when needed. Thank you. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong. Thank you. The AEF 2.0 of 137.5 billion is essential. There is always room for improvement. I think the administration has considered many aspects. However, we need to err on the safe side and not exclude anybody. I hope you will try to include everyone in your subsidy. We hear from the people that you need to take measures expeditiously. You need to think out of the box. To provide assistance and support to the people as soon as possible. There is a common thread in all the views of members that the government should consider a next round of AEF. Earlier, when I was in dialogue with some government officials, we did suggest a possibility of the AEF. Well, we joked about that, but could there actually be a possibility of an AEF 3.0? Hundreds of billions have been taken out from the coffers, and therefore I don't think there's much money left for a 3.0. But can you consider this? Well, thank you for your suggestion. We need to adopt these measures first. We would continue to review our measures as they are launched, and everything is dependent on the pandemic situation. When the pandemic is over and the economy is fully recovered, then there would be no need for further measures. We expected about 80,000 applications from the retail sector in the first round of AEF, but then we received over 90,000 applications, and we have already given out 800 million, which is around 10,000 applications. We are trying to be speedy in rolling out the measures. We know that people urgently need the money. Some retail shops tell me that they are very happy that they receive the subsidy within 2 weeks of application. We as civil servants are very lucky. We have a permanent job and permanent pay. We understand that it is tough for many who are not working in the government. Well, is there going to be a third round of AEF? Well, I can't guarantee that, but I will try my best. I can't make any empty promises here because we are just now trying to roll out the second round. Would it be too early to talk about AEF 3.0? But I will try my best. Dr. Lo Wei Kwok. Thank you, Chairman. The DAB has the BPA has been trying to propose many recommendations to the government to try to alleviate the difficult period, and we really are in support of the $137.5 billion in the AEF 2.0. I am sure that many people are paying attention to our meeting today, and I hope that we'll be able to focus on this topic so that we'll be able to have this approved as soon as possible. I do not want to see too many 37A motions moved to delay the approval. Many members have raised concern about those who are over the age of 65 and who are not making contributions to MPF. We see in the construction industry that there are many workers who are over the age of 65. Many of them are grassroots, and some of them are blue collars, some of them are white collars, but as they've already reached the age of 65, they do not need to contribute to MPF anymore, even though they did contribute before they reached the age of 65. Well, although Mr. Lo Chi Kwong said that the elderly can apply for old age allowance, I think that it's not very fair, and it's quite insulting to those who are still working after reaching the age of 65. Yes, I understand that there is support for them when they reach an elderly age. However, this is very insulting to them. I don't think you should wait for a third round. You should try to resolve the situation in the second round. Mr. Tony Tse just now talked about a specific issue. In the construction industry, there are contract workers who are actually professionals. They might only take a certain project. And when the works are completed, then their contract would be over, and then they would move on to the next contract. You can't cut it across the board and say that there should be the same number of employees at all times, because the construction industry operates differently. We cannot only take care of those in service employees. I'm actually concerned about students who are about to graduate this year. They may be entering the working field in a few months, and some of them may join the Team A study project. And so they would start their career path in a few months in the construction industry. How can you make sure that they can still continue with this sort of apprentice program? I hope the Vocational Training Council, as they now provide a $5,610 subsidy per month, I hope that they could add more support. Dr. Law, I don't think there is enough time for the CS to answer. I don't think you should also separate the subsidies into 20,000 and 10,000. I think everyone should receive the same amount of $20,000.
Next, Mr. Jeremy Tam. Thank you. I wonder if Mr. Frank Chen can answer this question for enclosure D212, the subsidy to the aviation sector. Each major aircraft would enjoy $1 million subsidy. For smaller aircrafts, $200,000. For those with an AOC, for private aircraft companies, they should hold an AOC, or the companies owning smaller aircrafts, they should be eligible for $200,000. Is that the case, Mr. Frank Chen? For AOC holders, for the subsidy levels, it would be $1 million and $200,000. So basically, companies owning aircrafts would enjoy a $200,000 subsidy. Are you referring to companies with at least one smaller aircraft or small aircraft? For Hong Kong Jets, Metro Jet, Tet Aviation, these companies operate private jet businesses. So the owners might have purchased the aircrafts, and the aircrafts would be managed by other operators. In that case, would they be entitled to receive the subsidy? If the answer is yes, that would be a problem. We are talking about owners of private aircrafts. They should not benefit. But according to your paper, they might be able to benefit. Basically, we are offering subsidies for aircraft owners. Basically, all locally registered airlines are required to hold the AOC. We would be prudent with the use of public money, so we do understand Mr. Tam's concerns. Well, that wasn't much of an answer. Owners of private aircrafts hold the exact same AOC. So according to the paper, for all AOC holders with locally registered aircrafts, they could enjoy subsidy for per large aircrafts and $200,000 per small aircrafts, and the threshold is 54.5 tons. So all private aircrafts would fall under this category. We have counted the number of commercially operated aircrafts at the Hong Kong International Airport, and like I said, privately owned aircrafts would not be eligible for the subsidy. So the purpose of the AEF is to support enterprises and boost employment. We must secure employment and the sustainability of businesses, and this is our objective. Can I get in touch with the relevant colleagues after the meeting? I'd like to know the exact aircraft models. Some aircraft holders would entrust their aircraft with someone holding an AOC. So it would be like a leasing arrangement. I think the same goes for a lot of commercial aircrafts. I'd like to know the models of aircrafts covered by the subsidy. If the aircraft models fall under the private aircrafts, would you be benefiting owners or operators of private aircrafts? We are happy to do that because we are obliged to ensure the proper use of public funds as well. All right, so please follow up on that after the meeting. Ms. Elizabeth Quad, since June last year, Hong Kong's economy has taken a hard hit. Many people have been in deep plight. I have proposed the creation of 30,000 jobs for the unemployed, and I'm happy that the CS has heeded our advice, and you are going to create 30,000 temporary jobs in the next 2 years. Our view is that a lot of people, especially the grassroots, are already unemployed. So we are of the view that the posts should be created immediately. That way, the unemployed can earn a living immediately and in a dignified manner. If the 30,000 jobs would only be created in the next 2 years, that would be too slow. You should be creating these jobs in the next few months. Some sectors find the second round of measures helpful, but for those age 65 or above who are still working and not enjoying NPF contributions would not benefit. the government is encouraging those age 65 and above to work, but in terms of the ESS, employees age above 65 without MPF contributions are not eligible. This is unreasonable. So is there other ways to support these people? We are afraid that the measure will prompt employers to fire all the employees older than 65 and rehire employees who are younger. That would take away a lot of jobs for those above age 65. For those who were dismissed or fired in January or subject to no pay leave, and more people could be dismissed going forward. The CS said we can all monitor the situation, but that would not help those who are unemployed. So the government should think about how this problem can be tackled. The government announced in January elderly persons above the age of 60 can enjoy the $2 concessionary fare. This can be done through the elderly octopus card. We don't understand why Dr. Lau Chi Kwong could not roll out this new concessionary fare as soon as possible, so that those aged 64 can benefit. And in terms of rents, again, you are not helping. So the DAB has been proposing incentives for the landlords to reduce rents, and we hope that the government would be more proactive. As for the 30,000 temporary jobs, our work would start immediately after this proposal is approved. So some examples are cited in the paper, and in the under the civil service establishment, we would hire more than 10,000 people, and there would be new posts. We also have 5,000 internship places. Some of them are for university students. So we will create these 30,000 jobs as soon as possible. Some of them would last 12 months, some longer, some shorter. Under the ESS, three of the sectors would enjoy dedicated schemes, and there are no age limits. The subsidy would last 6 months, so this safety net would cover at least 800,000 people. For the other questions, please wait for the next round. Next, Ms. Alice Mack. Under the $137.5 billion allocation, some of the employees can benefit, including tour guides, tour escorts, private hire car drivers, and these people can all benefit. We hope no one would stand in the way of this funding proposal. However, we must point out a major inadequacy of the AEF, that is, those unemployed could not benefit. Since August or September last year, many sectors were hit by black-clad violence. Many practitioners were hit. Even lots of catering and tourism practitioners had to take no-pay leave from last year. We propose an unemployment assistance program And together with the current pandemic, these employees have taken a double hit. And yet the government is reluctant to roll out an unemployment assistance. Dr. Lau Chi Kwong said on his blog that if they are to introduce an assistance scheme, it would take 9 months at the earliest. Since we proposed the idea last year, it has been at least 8 or 9 months. So with your intelligence and capability, why can't this be done? For the two rounds of AEF, the CS said speed is of great importance. And we saw that you could get things done quickly if you wanted. So why can't you introduce an unemployment assistance program? We do not want to stand in the way of the $137 billion assistance program. The tour guides, tour escorts, and drivers have suffered for a long time. Satri, you said people could apply for CSSA, but CSSA applicants are based on the household, not the individual. But the key now is to support unemployed individuals. Why is it so difficult? Why are you not offering unemployment assistance? Why aren't you helping those who are already unemployed? And like other members said, the ESS would encourage employers to dismiss employees above the age of 65 who have no NPF contributions. I'm sure the secretary could have seen that loophole. You cannot, every applicant is trying to deceive the government. You should not have this kind of bias. And instead, you should do something to really help the unemployed. So why are you refusing to plug this loophole? Why aren't you introducing an assistance program?
Thank you, Chairman. If there is more time, of course, we would have a more detailed discussion. But as time is limited, I can only give a brief explanation. Under the current scheme, we're looking into providing a one-off lump sum for the employees to help them go through these difficult times. Of course, some people will not receive the CSP. For low-income persons and for unemployed persons, if they do not receive adequate pay to sustain their basic survival, then our safety net will be able to assist them. Well, that is exactly my question. It is based on the household. It is not based on an individual. Well, don't try to confuse the two. Well, I'm not confused. This is actually a policy that can be subjected to further discussion. Some people misunderstand that those who receive CSSA will not be allowed to work, but actually quite many CSS recipients work for a living as well. Mr. Wu Qiwei, I do have a few concerns that I received that during the pandemic, they're not able to mobilize funds. They're not even able to sell flags to raise money. If they hire employees, can they also apply for subsidy from the government? And many of these organizations rely on donations to operate. Or since they're not able to raise money, can you help them? And if they've already applied for flag selling activities, yet these activities have been canceled due to the pandemic, and if they have already made a successful application and they did not carry out the activity, would they still be penalized? Another point is in relation to the transport industry. The different commercial vehicles receive different subsidies. However, for drivers of big trucks and lorries are not covered under the subsidy. I would like to ask Mr. Frank Chen why this does not include them. Because this industry is also heavily hit. Can you also provide some sort of timely relief for them? The third question is actually an inquiry. There are around 3.9 million people in the workforce in Hong Kong, and according to D1 of the paper, there are 1.5 million people who make contributions to the MPF, and they can apply for support through the ESS. So that means that around 2 million people, excluding drivers or some other people that are not benefiting from the scheme. Can you tell us the different numbers between the workforce and also those who do not contribute to the MPF but who remain in the workforce? And when you are considering assistance given to the people, there are around 300,000 active SMEs in the market. However, the government always emphasizes that it would be a huge sum were they to support all the SMEs. Are some of them shell companies, or are they all active companies? If not, I don't think you should exclude them in your scheme. Well, I'll try to address two of your questions. NGOs who make which make contributions for their staff would be included under the ESS. Secondly, you asked about the figure under the labor force. So there are 1 million people in the workforce who make contributions to MPF, and then there are 2.1 million who do not make MPF contributions, and then there are about 800,000 people who are in the catering, construction, and transport industries. And these are in the passenger carrying transport. And some of them are excluded. Civil servants are excluded. All subvented employees under the government, including LegCo and many schools, they are also excluded. So these are the figures for your reference. So there are around 100,000 who are not covered under the scheme. Well, yes, some of them are unemployed, some of them are not active practitioners, so they are not included. Next is Mr. Chan Hakan. Thank you, Chairman. In the past year, with all this violence and pandemic, the economic has suffered a huge setback. The government is now rolling out the second round of AEF, trying to support the industries and businesses. However, there are still loopholes. There are many unemployed who are not benefiting from the scheme. Those include those who are over the age of 65, who are not making MPF contributions, and some self-employed people. These people do not want to receive CSSA. They want to work. They want to support themselves. However, the government is just telling them to apply for CSSA. Were they in trouble? Many of them do not want to take this step forward. Can you think of ways to help these people? Can you try to roll out a third round of AEF to cover these exclusions? CSSA is household based, and the procedures are very complicated. It will be difficult for them to apply. Can you try to think of ways or maybe something new to help them? I have an inquiry as well. The Anti-epidemic Fund 2.0 will also provide coaches and instructors, as long as they are under NSAs or sports organizations, a $7,500 one-off fund. However, there are many temporary instructors and coaches under the LCSD. Are they also covered in the scheme? And there are also many NGOs which employ contract instructors and coaches. Can these people also receive the $7,500 fund CS? Well, you say that we are forcing people to apply for CSSA. We're not doing that. I think we just need to improve our PR and packaging. We do have 41 offices helping CSSA applicants, and now we are providing a special scheme. Actually, we don't need to use the term CSSA. We could actually use a temporary relief fund. We just need to rename it and try to package it so that it sounds better. The money provided is actually much more than basic CSA. We're talking about $16,000 for a four-person family. If you're just only applying for unemployment, then it's only about $5,000. So we are actually providing special relief right now. However, some people may think that the threshold is too high and the restrictions are too strict. We are trying our best to provide timely relief to those in need. I'd like to defer the second question to Mr. Lau, please. Thank you. Other than LCSD facilities, schools, NGOs are all included in the $7,500 fund. However, there may be individuals who work in fitness centers, so they can try to seek funding from the ESS as long as they have been making MPF contributions. Chairman, can you ask Mr. Lau to clarify whether some instructors for interest classes can also benefit from this? Or I can say that for those who are not included in the NSAs and sport organizations and LCSD, then they will need to apply through the ESS. Mr. Wei Chen, Chairman, well, I'm the 37th member asking question. Well, even if we all ask one round, you're not going to be able to have enough time to vote for this item within today? Well, I understand the administration has worked very hard and sacrificed your Easter holidays to come up with this paper. However, members do have a lot of views that we would like to express. I hope that you would try to amend the AEF 2.0. I see that many members from the pro-establishment camp are also very frustrated by this paper because they're not able to get their answers. Well, I think we should all work together and to fight the virus together, support Hong Kong together, as stated in this folder. We want to go fight the virus together. We all want to work together to support Hong Kong. We should actually discuss this without dividing into different political parties. We must help the needy. Unemployed people, taking no pay leave, they should all be the ones supported. However, this scheme actually does not really help everyone, so we should take a nonpartisan approach. We're not able to come up with a recurrent unemployment support that would take forever. I understand. However, we're only adopting temporary relief measures right now. We're only talking about a six-month relief to provide support for 6 months. This is what we are looking into. Is it impossible? No, we are already working on it. Well, look at the taxi industry. Taxi drivers can receive 6,000 per month for 6 months. Well, I'm not targeting taxi drivers here. They are hard hit as well. I know someone who actually rents taxis, yet they're not able to pay the rental fee, and what they earn a day cannot even support fuel. So I think that we should actually help them. Why do taxi drivers receive $6,000 for 6 months, yet other low-income people cannot receive this funding? Well, even if you can't do it today, at least you can make some short, mid, or long-term measures. You're not doing that. I'm sure different industries suffer differently. I met someone who works in a hair salon, and he doesn't understand why he is not receiving any support. Well, he asked whether, since he's selling hair products, is he also included in the support for the retail stores?
去那个，如果没有呢？
For the self-employed with MPF contributions, they can get $7,500. But the arrangements are not very clear. For MPF contributors who are unemployed, who are self-employed, they can enjoy $7,500. So you talked about MPF contributions in the last 15 months. Does it mean that it would apply to people who have made at least one MPF contribution? For coaches, interest class, instructors, they can get $7,500. Can they enjoy the $7,500 twice, Dr. Law? From the 1st of January 2019 to 31st of March this year, those who have contributed to their MPF accounts would be eligible. Can you offer a brief response, Mr. Lau? Thank you. In terms of coaches, they can apply for both at the same time. Mr. Ma Fenghua, thank you. The government has reacted swiftly after the first, well, the first round of measures helped some of the sectors, including mine. I strongly support the second round of measures because they were derived based on the needs of the community and the pandemic. I support such employment or job retention measures. The second round of measures seeks to plug the inadequacies, but a lot of friends from the trade told me that they are yet to benefit, even though there has been a big improvement over the first round. And I'd like to relay some of their views to the government to see if the scope can be further expanded. First of all, there are a lot of self-employed practitioners in my sector. Many of them don't even have an NPF account, so they would not benefit from the second round of measures. So what would the government deal with this? This includes arts and culture practitioners, coaches, etc., as well as the film industry. They have been hit hard since the blood-clad violence occurred in Hong Kong. As of this year, only well, filming has started for only one film, and it is a first feature film initiative movie. We, well, I propose support to be provided through the Film Development Fund, but the government said that was not the intention of the fund. Can you roll out new measures to support the elite practitioners of the film industry? A number of LCSD venues were closed, and affected groups and self-employed individuals were eligible for subsidies for other facilities such as community halls and community centers. Their closures have affected a lot of groups, such as drama groups, which would in turn affect practitioners. So would they be covered as well? In the first and second round of measures, a $7,500 subsidy would be offered to the self-employed. So together with the $10,000 cash payout for each adult individual, the total is $17,500. For a lot of interest class instructors, they could not resume teaching till at least August, while sports instructors or coaches might have to endure the summer as well. So what good would $7,500 or $17,500 do for them? It's not possible to cover their costs over a 4 to 6 month period, which you consider offering a higher sum. As for local arts and culture groups, they have been seriously affected, and this includes music centers, table tennis centers, visual arts centers as well. They do not receive any one-off subsidy, and yet they were hit very hard. Would the government consider a one-off subsidy for them? Currently, fitness centers have to remain closed. So those engaging in dance or martial arts are eligible for $100,000. But would the relevant groups also enjoy the subsidy? There won't be enough time to answer the questions in the current round, so please answer those questions in Mr. Ma's next round. Mr. Ray Chan urged us to stand united, but what he meant was that we should embrace a "if we burn, you burn with us" mentality. I think instead we should stand united in urging the government to launch a third round of measures. After this proposal is approved, the government should roll out the third round as soon as possible, and I hope the opposition camp would do the same. Dr. Lau Chi-Kwang, you should learn a lesson from Mr. Frank Chen. For the taxi drivers or taxi owners, they are eligible for some kind of subsidy. The government is reluctant to pay the unemployed due to an absence of a reliable list. But for the taxis industry, we don't actually need a complex database. We just need a spreadsheet. Those who have enjoyed subsidies would not be eligible. That way we can help this group of unemployed people. There's no need to build a database of personal data. A simple spreadsheet would do. Mr. Frank Chan, we helped certain operators or owners of boats, and they have lost all business. And with the gathering prohibition order, the Marine Police would not allow gatherings on the boat. As for musicians who cannot benefit from the ESS or other employment support schemes, are there other ways to help them? By negation, would people who could not benefit from either round of measures be given some support? Can Mr. Frank Chan and Mr. Lau Kong Wah think about this for the third round? You are asking people to prove whether they belong in a certain industry, but for the benefit of the people, could something be done for some of these industries? Mr. Lau? Dr. Lau? I have exchanged views with LegCo members in terms of unemployment. How do we prove someone is unemployed? You might suggest ideas such as a dismissal letter, but as to how long he or she has worked, this is not as straightforward as you thought. We can collect Hong Kong identity card numbers. Those who have received assistance would not be eligible again. Many self-employed persons are not eligible because they are not employees and they have no MPF contributions. For individual vessel owners or operators, can they enjoy a subsidy? Mr. Frank Chan. our support for the taxi and minibus sectors should not be confused with the ESS. The ESS cover a lot more employees, so the two are not comparable. For the taxi and minibus industries, the ESS would consider MPF contributions. Well, that was a praise. You have done a very good job, so other industries should take a leaf from your book. Dr. Priscilla Lang, thank you. Speed is of paramount importance in offering support. I hope the opposition camp would not object to the $137 billion allocation. That way, we can help people as soon as possible. The same can be said of the statutory for labor and welfare. Earlier this year, you said you would explore extending the $2 concessionary fare to those between 60 and 64. In the bureaucracy, there could be plenty of barriers to stop you from giving out money, but you should not only be thinking about potential abuse. That should not stand in the way of your work. For many people who are out of a job, the $2 concessionary fare is very important. This should not drag on for so long. I know friends who have received a payout in the US already. The various government departments should hold the personal data of the public. The cash out, the payout should not take so long. We should not have to wait till after the summer. So people are frustrated with the government. And in terms of unemployment assistance, I understand you cited difficulties, but many people are only out of the job temporarily. Hopefully, they do not want to apply for CSSA.
Some people may only be in between jobs. Well, you are suggesting $9,000 for unemployed. Well, nobody wants to admit that they're unemployed, they've lost their jobs. Not many people want to admit that they cannot find a job. They do want to work for their own living. So don't think that people are just going to abuse these measures. I think you really should try to provide assistance to those who originally have jobs, yet they have been temporarily laid off due to the pandemic. Self-employed people, those who work in hair salons, they understand that the government is trying very hard, yet they are not included in these measures. Can you provide flexibility to the employer to decide on how to allocate the funding? And we should not exclude the possibility of AEF 3.0. I hope that we are blessed and that we will be able to overcome this difficult period as soon as possible. CS, I'll address 2 points and then I'll defer to Mr. Law for the $2 concessionary fare question. For those who are registered with the Construction Council, then they can receive $7,500. there are around 20,000 workers who are able to receive this $7,500 relief. And this morning, we've spent a lot of time explaining I've also been in the Labor and Welfare Department for many years. And of course, we want to try our best to provide assistance to everyone. We're now providing a special scheme for unemployed in this difficult period. This is actually part of our structure. This is not CSSA. We're actually providing extra temporary funding. Well, you have to wait for next round to have these other questions answered because time is up. Mr. Wilson or Chairman, I'd like to thank the administration for many fruitful results. The second round of AEF is to retain jobs and create jobs. We see many families suffering in this pandemic. They have lost their jobs and they are barely able to sustain their families. We really must act in a speedy manner and to provide timely relief. The cooked food stalls are included in the second round. Tutorial centers were not able to benefit from the first round, and now they're also included. And I'm very grateful to that. We really must try to give out the funding in a timely manner. People have asked me how long it would take to receive the funding after this is approved today. Mr. Law said that the funding for the unemployed would be a more relaxed threshold for CSSA. Actually, Hong Kong people are very resilient and they want to work for their own living. Many people do not want to apply for CSSA. Can you actually think of better ways to help them? I think people are very concerned with the name of this scheme. The CS has mentioned different relief measures for those over the age of 65. As they do not contribute to the MPF, they are not able to benefit from the measures. There are some who are in the entertainment industry who are also trying to overcome this difficult period. And friends from the production industry and also those from the laundry service industries. Can you try to think of ways to help these people as well? Can you share with me how long it would take for the money to reach the hands of the people after this goes through today? Can you actually give out the money in a timely manner? Well, we are acting expeditiously. I've given you the example of the retail industry earlier. The retail industry seems very complicated. How do you define retail? We have already given out the first round of relief within 3 weeks of applications. The deadline for application was a few days ago. We've already given out 800 million to about 10,000 applicants. we are trying to streamline all the procedures to be as simple as possible. We are trying to be more lax than strict. And we are holding this yardstick in our procedures. Well, I hope that you would really try to hand out the money as soon as possible, and then to tell us about the details of applications as soon as possible, because people right now do not understand how to apply for the funding. Do you actually have to fill out a physical form, or do you apply online? Nobody knows how to apply. Perhaps you could follow up after the meeting today. Dr. Pierre Chen, you'll be the last to ask questions this morning. Thank you, Chairman. Well, there have been many measures for businesses. Can the DFEH actually explain to us what measures there are for dentists? Thank you for your question. Well, actually, we understand that private medical practitioners play a very important role during this period. I have communicated with many private practitioners, and some of them can benefit under the ESS, because if they hire people and make MPF contributions, they are able to apply for the ESS. And that is a very important part. We have also made or adopted measures to waive a registration fee for the next 3 years. And this is what we have been trying to do to help. Oh, thank you, Secretary. Well, actually, this does not target private medical clinics. There are no measures that target private dental clinics and their practitioners. In November of last year and in February and March of this year, I have written letters to the administration and to you, Secretary, about the troubled times private medical clinics are going through. Practitioners who were in close contact with confirmed cases also had to go into quarantine. You were actually not listening to us. You're asking us to help us to do monitoring work and follow-up work, yet you're not taking care of us private medical practitioners. Secretary, as someone with a professional medical background, how do you feel practitioners who would rather choose N95 over a one-time disposable P18 mask? Are you talking about the public hospitals? I'm talking about both public and private. Because when medical practitioners are taking care of patients, we would rather use a disposable N95 and PPE instead of reusable masks such as P18 or P100. Well, although this is not directly related to the AEF, I'll try to answer your question. Well, I'll tell you why it is directly related. For public hospitals, we do have infection control team monitoring the protective equipment, including face mask and PPE, whether they're able to control infection. The WHO has also issued latest information and guidelines. Well, there are only 10 seconds left. I'll tell you know what is related. Because the AEF, some of the money of the AEF is used to explore reusable protective gear. And actually, we want you to understand that we do not want reusable gear because that would lead to double infection. We want to use one-use protective equipment. We, as practitioners, do not want to use reusable gear because that is very risky. People have been infected by using reusable gear overseas. I don't understand why you want to look into reusable gear. We actually do not want to see that. I hope that you would share some of these professional views with your staff. We'll now adjourn the morning meeting. We will resume at 3 in the afternoon.